Welcome to the Totally Awesome Fishing Show. Going to be giving you a few tips about float fishing. Now then, one of the problems you can get is when you're trying to let the float go down just on the same pace or a little bit less than the flow of the river. It can be a bit tricky. And if you start stopping and starting, on off, the float jerk stops, the bait does the same. Just as it goes to a fish's face, he goes, whoa, that looks unusual, that's not normal. Anything coming down with the river is going at a constant, even speed in the upper layers or tumbling and bumping along the bottom on the lower layers. So how can you do a little bit of smooth float fishing, make life easy for yourself? Well, listen, let's have a look at this first. So we just explained for the beginners the different types of reels. When you're float fishing with a standard fixed spool or spinning reel, as they say, like this, you have to open the bail arm, put the line in your finger, cast out, bring your left hand round, you can close it like that. Or as you cast out, you turn the handle and it automatically closes that bail arm like that. See, automatic. Most float fishermen don't do it like that. I find they tend to cast out and just knock it with their hand because they want to keep on and off, open, on, off, open like that. So that is a fixed spool, as we call them in England, a regular one, which you can't open this with one hand. I can't get it over, okay? There is a fixed spool or spin reel that does have that facility. So the same thing, look, little small one, and it's got at the top of the bail arm here, just a little trigger guard. So if you wanted to float fish with this one, look, you just pull this trigger, and the line is actually on your finger at the same time. You still have to either close it manually or clunk it round. But for quickness, you've got that trigger release there. Bang. The line straight on your finger, cast out. Okay? Little bit better, still not perfect. The old school reel we used years ago was called a closed face reel. I'll just show you the two. It's one of these. So there's a regular one. You can see it's open. The actual spool is open. This is closed, but if I just take this off there, just take the cap off there, the spool is under there. Now look at the diameter of the two spools. This one, this side, is absolutely way bigger than this one. I'm not saying it's double the size, it's much bigger. So this is gonna have memory retention around here. Off the coils coming off will be a little bit sticky going through the rod rings. So a lot of matchmen, a lot of people used to like using these for float fishing years ago because of the wider spool. And the fact that when it's locked on, it is just there. The line straight on your finger, cast out, turn the reel, it's back in. See, it's really quick, it's really easy. But another little tip that I've been using for years is this. If you want to float fish, I mean, I don't suppose there's many people use these nowadays, so I don't know. But closed face reels are very, very good for float fishing. Good line control and a nice gear ratio. But what you can do to stop this line sticking is basically this. You peel the line off all over the carpet. You let it go all over the carpet. Obviously avoid things like dogs and children running through it. Pull off about what you think you're going to float for, say, 30 yards. That'd be quite a long... I can't see a float more than 40 yards away for sure. Peel the line off, close this, put it down. You get then a little bit of polish. Just spray it onto a duster, a rag, a towel like this. Look, give it... Okay, you put the line between that and you slide it up and down the line, and that creates a little bit of slickness to the line. It helps it slide through the rod rings, and you'd be surprised the amount of black you'll get off if you use a clean white thing, a white handkerchief, but it's like a clean white cloth. When you do that, you'll be quite surprised you'll see lines there. It's actually dirt on there, bits of grit, very, very fine. You won't see generally. When you use it, you won't see it. You use it with a clean rag, you'll go, oh my God, no wonder it's sticking through the rings. You want that float going through as smoothly as you can. I'm going to do that to my reels, and then I'm going fishing down the river and give it a shot, see if I can't pick off some nice, big, fat dace. Now, when you've done that, get a dry piece of the duster, turn it over, you've got the end of the fishing line here, and pull the fishing line back through the duster, And you'll feel immediately, you should do anyway, that is so slick, it absolutely slides through. Do it nice and slowly. Any loose coils, just shake out and you won't get any tangles. Don't rip any yank at it. Just let it go through loosely. And there you go. How long did that take, guys? About 2 minutes. And I'm ready now. Reload this onto here. And that's going on smooth already. I can feel it going on there smoothly. And that will stay on the surface as well. Let's get fishing. I'm down here to do some urban dace fishing. It doesn't get any more urban than this. There's a road there on the other side of this side stream. There's a main dual carriageway. Can't tell you. 20 yards away, there's going to be traffic noise. That's what urban fishing is all about. It's noisy, but listen, I hopefully have picked, just for a change, the right conditions. The river has been dropping, the main river, and it's been sort of, not really flooded, but it's been up and pushing. And that means this side stream has actually got water flowing through it. That means a lot of fish are going to come in here. Could be, it's probably small stuff, dace, chub. There's some big dace in here, I do know that for sure. Roach, might get the odd roach in here, baby chub, stuff like that. Might even be some perch and minnows. But the fish do come up these side streams to sort of shelter out of the main current. I mean, it makes sense not to fight the current, doesn't it, really? So, what I'll be using is a match rod, but I'm using a close-faced reel. I don't know if you've seen this, with a button on the front. That's the one I showed you back in a little tackle room there. And I'm going to start probably feeding with some pellets first, some 4mm pellets and some red and white mags, and just bounce between the two hook baits, see what sort of bite situation we can get going here. I've got the umbrella up, not because it's going to rain, because I'm trying to shut down the constant drone of traffic noise. One of the guys fishing down there is so bad, he's got earplugs. He's got earplugs in there. Can you blame him? Now, the feeding's going to be on the little Loughlin basis. It's just a small size stream. The rod's 13 feet long, I don't suppose. It's probably not even 13 feet wide. So I'm going to be using mostly loose feed, and that's those 4mm pellets, lots of little pellets in there. Maybe put a dozen at a go, keep feeding through almost every trot through with the float. It'll be a moving float going through the river. Then I've got just a pint of red and white maggots, because obviously I'm feeding more with the pellets than I am with the maggots. Of course you can go and buy 10 quid's worth of maggots, 10 pounds if you so wish. And I use red and white to bounce between the two colours, because in the winter, sometimes red can be very good. As for the rod, just a standard 13 foot match rod. Turn the name round so you can't see the name of it. Makes no difference, it's just a cheap match rod, but we're not going to give many publicity. And at the other end, I've got this. I'm going to be using a wire stem stick, which is a sort of bodied stick float. Let me show you. Okay, getting nice and close. There you can see it's bodied here, like a balsa bodied, but it's a stick. A wire stem goes through there. So you have a band here at the top. When I say a band, it's a piece of valve rubber. I've actually got the wrong size. It's on there really tight, so hopefully that'll stay. And you need a smaller one at the bottom. I could have done without having yellow, it's a bit bright, but there's a little bit of tinge of colour in the water, so hopefully the fish won't mind. I'm probably on 4 pound up to here. I've got a hook link, which is, I should tell you, it is a size 18 hook. It's a barbless carp feeder to 2 pound 12 ounces. You can buy them in the packets. Let's turn that round, so no free advertising for anybody, folks. There's the hooks to nylon. I used to make my own hooks to nylon, but to be honest, it's not really worth making them now. This float takes 3BB, so I got them spaced out, what they call sort of shirt and button style. Maybe a couple at the top. The most important one, here's the hook with the bait. Maybe a foot, and I can move that up and down depending how the bites come. Whether I, you know, get bites in faster current or slower current, I can move that shot up and down. I'm going to start with white maggots. Going to run those through, and if I do get fish on them, I shall stay with them, but I have the feeling red maggots might be doing the business today. Sometimes with white maggots in very clear water, the fish, and this is hammered this stretch here, this gets a lot of attention. I'm lucky, actually, I couldn't even get where I want to go with the other guy was, but I've had to come up the top end, so I have no idea what it's like. Anyway, I'm at the top end where it flows in. So let's get a bait out there and see if we can't nail one of these days. And there are some absolutely, oh man alive, spanking dace in this place. We'll start probably with two maggots and go up and down from there depending on the bite situation. Here we go. Under any high water or almost semi-flood conditions, there's going to be an area, it could be the side of ditches, the side creeks, could be side streams, where the flow is less. And if the flow is less, the fish are going to be up in there. It's a classic scenario that you sort of find less and less now on the larger rivers. Some of them have been what's called canalised, which is straightened, all the bends are taken out. There's nowhere for the fish to hold up and get out of the current. But if you can find somewhere that's got a little bit of slack, even along the edges like here, it's definitely worth a go. Whereas the main centre of the river is very swirly, it's very powerful, it's where most of the actual current is going down. You can see it there, it's barreling down there, and this is by no means flood conditions. Then it's worth a shot in the slack conditions. And also worth a shot is having a pub called the Fish Inn right next to the river. So there you can see, that's that slacker water, it's still moving, it's good for float fishing. I'm getting set up, I'm all ready to take a crack at whatever is in there. There you go, guys. That's the sort of dace I'm talking about that come through on this swim. I've actually fallen off the hook. That was on double white. Just to show you this little fish, if it holds still. A really good silver bodied fish there. They're in good condition this time of year in the winter. Best time to catch them. And fingers crossed, going to get quite a few more. There we go, guys, the seal will be coming on now. Probably picking off the occasional maggots. Don't forget that the formal pellets are going to sink faster than the maggots, so you can come up and down the float. That's urban dace fishing. And I tell you what, they're pretty big fish, aren't they? Now you can see here the float going down, and by mending the line you see those little tweaks on the float. If you watch it as you go to let more line spill off, you'll see those little vibrations coming onto the float from the rod top and the reel. And that has got to be kept to a minimum if you don't want to avoid spooking those fish. So drop the float over there and just let that line gently spill off the front of the reel. Maybe lift the rod top very slowly or flick it occasionally if it does stick, and then you want to leave it alone as much as you can.
And as soon as the float dips, strike, set the hook, play the fish and try and pull it to the left. You can see I'm trying to get it away from the area where the rest of the shoal is. So if I'm catching on the far right bank, I'm trying to play the fish up on the near side bank there, so any splashing minimises the disturbance to any other fish in the shoal. You can see out on the main river here by those bridge buttresses, it's absolutely barreling through there. But as soon as you come back inside this little ditch, this side stream, this whatever you want to call it, a little channel down here, the flow, the edge has been taken off the flow. It's much easier to float fish, smoother. And of course, here we go, going to bait up with, if I can get them on the hook for you, three white maggots. And nothing can refuse that, surely, that wriggly bait. Just let it run down. You can use a single maggot, you can use a double maggot. And what you can also do is induce a take by holding the float back just as it reaches the point where you're going to hopefully get a bite. You just ease it back and the bait will go in front of the float there. Just hold it back. Any second now, I'm going to be holding it back. There's the hold back, teasing it back slowly so the bait goes. There's the bite. It just lets the bait go in front of the float because due to the friction of the river running over the bed, the actual riverbed itself, it is faster on the top of the river and slower on the bottom. So therefore the float's going to want to try and be in front of the bait on a vertical plane. And that is a nice chunky day, sir. Happy with that, pop it in the keep net. So remember that, if you're running the float down there, when you get to what I call the kill zone, then try and hold the float back very, very gently to send the bait in front of the float. And that way the fish see the bait before they see the float. Indeedy, it works, because here comes another prime chunky dace, what we call in the trade herrings. Remember to keep that loose feed going in pretty regularly. If you can get in the habit of doing it on every cast down, it's wise to do so. It's a good habit to get into. And of course those pellets sink a lot faster than the maggots do. And as the float goes down, you might want to do what we call lead the feed. You might want to put the float in first and then throw your maggots in. So as you gradually hold the float back in the current, as I mentioned earlier, that allows all the cloud bait to catch up with your hook bait. And by the time it gets to what we call the kill zone, where the fish are hopefully laying up and hopefully feeding, they won't tell the difference. Your hook bait should be right in the middle of a cloud of loose feed, be it pellets or maggots. And there we go, another fish hooked up there. Great sport on a match rod. It really is entertaining fishing, even if it's an extremely noisy environment.
Got a laugh, folks. I mean, I've really been caned in the day, so I've got to tell you, I had to put the camera down. It's so noisy here, and now somebody's tried to break into a shop over there. The alarm's going, I've heard police sirens around, I don't know if they're going to chase them. It's not me, I'm innocent, I'm on the river fishing. So noisy, got traffic pouring past, it's true urban fishing, burglar alarms going off, sirens going around. I haven't been mugged yet, that's one good thing, I suppose. What I'm going to do, guys, I've done really, really well. I'll tell you how good I've done. 40 big days. Got them in the net. Well, hopefully it's not a hole in the net, because I'm going to look pretty stupid. So I've had a good old fish up. I've got some bran. The only thing I went in the car, I had no ground bait, and I'm running low, so I'm really going to start whaling it in, which I normally don't do. I've been catching very, very well on the traditional matchman's
with a stick float, let them off, you know, just small bits going in. But I'm going to get rid of this stuff. I'm going to see if it does put them off, as people say, can you overfeed them, or will it bring them on even more? Because it's late afternoon now, I've got maybe an hour, hour and a half of light left. That's the time the roach might come on. Maybe something else might happen, but I've had some spanking days in this urban environment. I won't be staying in the dark, but it's perfectly safe, I guess. Anyway, let's get this mixed up, get it in the water, see what happens.
Just gradually damp that bran in stages. Don't put too much water in, because you're very, very easy to over wet bran. Just keep adding slowly until you get some sort of binding with it. It won't stick together, but it's still a good loose feed. And then into that, just scatter a few loose hook samples. Could be, you know, your pellets, maggots, worms, sweet corn, whatever you want, and get it in the water.
Now this is just bran. I always keep some bran in the car in case I need it for shark fishing trips or backups anywhere. It's very, very light and fluffy. It doesn't bind. It's going to sink slowly, but it's got that, well, 4 mil pellets and some maggots in there. So I've got to chuck it further upstream, so it's got plenty of time to sink. And I'm hoping by the time it gets to the bottom, I might pick a roach off at the bottom. That's the theory anyway, but I'm having a great time fishing, even though I'm almost deaf. Guys, I'm getting really complacent now. I've got so many big days, it's ridiculous. I've now had 51 days. Some of these are clunkers, but it doesn't look it from the camera, but the light's going, and I want to show you the bag of fish I've got in the net first. Let me just get this one in. I should be netting it. Oh my God, what about that? What about that for a day, said people? That, honestly, is not the biggest days of the day. It's a lump, isn't it, for God's sake? Look at the size of it. Absolutely, it's half a pound of anybody's money. 3 red maggots. So that bran I threw in didn't make any difference. They just ate everything, and they're still eating everything. Just look at that dace. What a spank. I've had an unbelievable day. Glad I finished the work. That work hard, fish hard really does pay off. Get it out of the way. I've only been here for an afternoon, for goodness sake. There we go. I'm going to pull that net out while there's a bit of light around. You might be impressed with the number of big dace I've got in there. Hopefully there's not a hole in the net. We'll show you some fish. It's getting cold, guys. Look at my breath. Well, it's better looking at it than smelling it, surely. I'm going to put the head cam on because it's starting to rain. I just think I've got minutes to try and get your shot here, so I'm going to use this camera and the big camera, and just hopefully you get something. Probably won't do any more talking because it's so noisy here, I don't even know if you're going to be hearing anything.